We talk in class about income as a very broadly defined term, and that under legislative grace, everything that you receive is subject to income tax. You dig up some cash in the backyard, you're supposed to pay tax on that. A couple interesting applications of the very broad what is gross income question. One of them happened when Mark McGwire was chasing Roger Maris's home run record and hit number 62, which broke the single season record. Everybody knew this was coming, and there was an appraiser in St. Louis who said, I'll pay $1 million for that ball. So now the value of the ball was set, and the question is, whoever caught the ball, do they now have $1 million of gross income? And I think the tax law would say yes. So as it turned out, the ball was caught in the bullpen by a groundskeeper. Now he was on the job and working for the Cardinals. So if there's gross income, is it to the groundskeeper as a guy, or is it to the team because he's working for them? Then the game was over, and he gave the ball back to Mark McGwire. Has there now been a gift, a transfer? There's no deduction. Is there gift tax due on the value of the ball? And so most of these questions really should be interpreted anti-taxpayer. There should be a lot of tax money due. But 3 days after the home run was hit, the IRS commissioner, also a baseball fan, said, we don't want to get involved with this. Whatever laws there are, we're not going to enforce them. Congratulations on your home run. And we won't be auditing anybody's tax return on this issue, maybe on something else. So I think there was some reason that came due as a result of that. The number of cases where gamblers have their luck turned bad and the tax law makes it even worse. There was one guy who went to Las Vegas, lost all of his money, went to the window, got a loan, got credit for $5 million, lost all of that. And so afterwards, he's up in the meeting with the head of the casino and says, I got no money. I can't pay you back your $5 million. They negotiate. And the casino guy says, all right, I'll tell you what. We'll be settled at $2.4 million. Pay up that, and we'll call it even. So now the question is, does the gambler not have discharge of indebtedness income of $2.6 million? And I think the answer is probably yes. If he had a payable of $5 million and the casino said, we'll waive $2.6 million of that, he's got gross income to that amount and a big tax bill to pay, in addition to having lost $6 million of money that most of which he's going to have to pay up as he goes. So the tax question is, how much gross income did the guy have? Discharge of indebtedness is a tricky thing, but the courts tend to apply the law very closely. This time, though, the court said, well, I'll tell you what. It looked for a moment like he was going to lose $5 million, have to pay that back, but really he was negotiating with the house, and they ended up negotiating for $2.4 million, and if he pays that back, that's his payable, and that's the amount due, and there's no discharge of indebtedness, therefore no gross income. Now, you still got to pay up what you owe, but at least the income tax issue went away. Now, another question of that, if you think about the deduction side of that, if he would have had a deduction for the $2.4 million that of the casino's money that he did lose, what kind of deduction is that? Is that a gambling loss? Is that a business loss because he was negotiating with a business associate? That the court didn't go into. That's interesting as well. You can deduct gambling losses only up to the amount of gambling winnings. And this guy apparently didn't know how to win, and so I don't think he'd get any deduction for the 2.4 that he would have to pay. So you're involved in a lawsuit, and you win, and you collect damages. And you know from watching Law and Order and so on that the contingent fee that personal damage attorneys take is usually one-third of the settlement. So let's say that you win a settlement, discrimination, loss of reputation, so on, of $6 million. The attorney gets two, you get four. How much gross income do you have? Was it the gross amount of six, or was it the net amount of four? And legislative grace, I don't see any exception there to say you take your proceeds net. That should be gross income of six with a perhaps deductible payment for attorney's fees of two. Well, the problem with that is that personal attorney fees are not a deductible amount. If anything, they show up as a miscellaneous itemized deduction only to the amount that they exceed 2% of AGI. So there was a court case that debated, was it six or was it four? And the court came down on the plain view of the law that he had gross income of six. What he did with that was up to him. If he had contracted for a contingent attorney fee, that's his business. But the income side of the tax law says gross, $6 million, deal with it. And so it was a number of court cases over the years took this issue into account. This was highest level, pretty recent case. And so we're going to assume that that's the law now until Congress does something different. Congress has softened that law a little bit since that tax on the gross rule came through. It said for certain federal damage claims, like for sexual or racial discrimination, those would be able to be reported net of the attorney fees. But everybody else in every other lawsuit would be gross income equals the gross of six in my example. Tough tax settlement. Even though you feel good about losing, about winning the court case, you lost from a tax standpoint. That's another reason that people need good tax advice and that we're ready to give that to them. So tying up some odds and ends on the income chapter, on chapter four, a few nuances there that we didn't get into class. I'm glad we had a chance to come back and look at them now.